The rapture of the church, one of the most controversial topics debated amongst Christians. No one can agree at what point the rapture is going to take place, whether it is before, in the middle, or after the tribulation. So, which is right? Is pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib the correct view of the rapture? I grew up believing in the pre-trib rapture, and the Left Behind series definitely helped with that. But, like most people, I just accepted it. They said their few verses that supported their point of view, and I was content. But a few years ago, I began studying eschatology for myself, and found myself struggling with the pre-trib view. I learned about the other interpretations and how they viewed the same passages. Each point of view had a valid point going for them, but then each view also had a valid point against them. So after studying and reading commentaries for a couple years, I decided to dedicate myself to studying without a single piece of commentary. I needed to take away the interpretations from the different points of view and just start from a blank slate. So I read, and reread all the apocalyptic literature for years until I could finally just allow the verses to speak for themselves, and this is what I found out. They are all right, but also all wrong. The pre-trib folks say Christians are not going to experience God's wrath, which I agree. Then the mid-trib folks say, wait, it obviously stated in Revelation 7, 9-17, Christians are coming out of the tribulation. So the first half is man's wrath, and the second half is God's wrath. Well, while I don't agree with the man's wrath and God's wrath interpretation, I do agree with the time of the rapture, but I'm not mid-trib. Then finally, the post-tribbers say, did you guys even read Matthew 24? It clearly says after the tribulation of those days, and then he will have his angels gather his elect. We are going through the tribulation, which, playing with the semantics, I also agree. So what is the problem? I realized it all boils down to the interpretation of one word, tribulation. A pre-trib pastor defined tribulation as, this coming time of tribulation is a time when the earth is going to experience the wrath of the Lamb. But also, tribulation and great tribulation are interpreted as two different times, where one encompasses the seals for the first 3.5 years, and the other encompasses the trumpets, Revelation 12-14, and bowls for the last 3.5 years. This interpretation is not scripturally accurate and forces people to do logical and scriptural acrobatics to prove their positions. The tribulation, or great tribulation, which happens before the beginning of the day of the Lord, is simply a time of distress for the saints lasting 3.5 years. That is it. So I fundamentally disagree with each position because their conclusions are based on a misunderstood interpretation of what the tribulation is. Instead of addressing each position, I am going to express how I come to understand the tribulation. Where would I place the time of the tribulation? Right here. Let's zoom in a bit. I would place the time of great distress of the saints, or the tribulation, sometime between the 4th and 5th seal. To solidify this claim, I believe it is valuable to show the parallel progressions in the Bible to the tribulation, or great tribulation, with the first 6 seals. The first seal, we have a white horse, which is supported by these verses. Be sure to read what I display in this video. Some verses will have A, B, or C next to it, meaning the verse is a list, and I am using the progression of the list in connection to the other passages. It is important that you actually study these verses and not simply take my word for it. The second seal is a bright red horse. These events are supported by these verses. With the third horse, I did not find direct verses stating the same events. But with the fourth horse, a pale horse, these verses support it. They do not, however, mention about a quarter of the population dying. Notice the parallel progression of these verses, though. Next, we have the souls of those who have been slain for the word of God in the fifth seal. Naturally, this is supported by the verses next in the progression, but also explained in depth in these verses. Here is something important to recognize about a misunderstanding about the tribulation and the great tribulation. In Matthew 24:9, it says we will be delivered up to tribulation, while in verse 21 it says there will be great tribulation when the abomination of desolation is set up. But look at the other two books about the abomination of desolation. In Mark, which was written first, it is only called tribulation, while in Luke it is called great distress and wrath against this people. This cross-defining tactic helps us know what something means. Furthermore, what is happening is that Jesus is giving more detail to what he already talked about when he first mentioned the tribulation and a brief of its events. The section about the abomination of desolation ends with Jesus talking about false Christs and prophets, which is what Jesus already mentioned at the end when he mentioned wars, famines, and being persecuted in Matthew. Jesus is talking about the same time, just with more detail. The tribulation and great tribulation are the same tribulation. People use this to determine two different periods of time. the tribulation or great tribulation is only a time of distress of the saints. It's just this one is special. It's the last one. As we can see, the tribulation or great tribulation is only mentioned here in the natural progression. Read the cross-referenced verses. It clearly talks about a time against the saints, not God's wrath or judgment, seals, trumpets, or bowls. When we compare these verses, we can see the tribulation happens before the beginning of the day of the Lord. Using Daniel, we know it will be about 3.5 years. We have four sources, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and Revelation, revealing events in succession to each other, along with other verses, helping us clarify the tribulation. There are no scriptural or logical gymnastics going on here. The last seal has the most verses referencing it. Naturally, we have our verses from the parallel progression, but look at all these other verses. The first four have the same detail, while the others just mention about the day of the Lord. There could be more, but this is all I could find. Right after the sixth seal is where I would place the rapture. These are the verses next in the parallel progression supporting it, as well as our famous verses in 1 Thessalonians and a couple verses in Daniel. You may have noticed I put Revelation 13 as a support for the tribulation. If you look at what this chapter is talking about, it explains in detail the events expressed briefly in the other verses. Context clues help us realize this is the tribulation, while Revelation 12 is building up to the tribulation. These events happen before the sixth seal. Revelation 12 through 14 is not talking about people who become Christians after the rapture during the old definition of tribulation. Revelation 12 through 14 is the same literary tactic Jesus used when talking about the abomination of desolation in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. It is a recall to give us more detail. Revelation does this a couple times. Between seals 6 and 7, the book stops to give more detail with the 144,000 Jews and the great multitude. And between trumpets 6 and 7, the book stops to give us more detail about the angel and the small scroll and the two witnesses. Before we end with the last plagues of the bowls of God's wrath, we are given more detail about the tribulation, that is, the great distress of the saints. So when we end with the harvest of the earth, we jump back to the end with the plagues of God's wrath. But I have a suspicion that the seventh trumpet happens right about the same time as the seventh bowl. The harvest of the earth is described in Matthew 13:24-30. This is when the weeds are being gathered first to be burned before the rapture, which is when the wheat is being placed into the barn. The weeds are all the false Christs leading people astray during the great trouble, the tribulation, not general non-believers. I want to reveal one last thing. What are the first four seals? They are how you crumble a nation, predisposing them. But instead of one country, it will be the world. The world will long for hope, and an individual will snatch the opportunity. Then somehow that individual will focus his hatred on the saints, justifying a reason to murder them. Seem far-stretched? This is exactly how Hitler came to power and killed the Jews. Jesus warned us repeatedly about false Christs. When people's fear cloud their own judgment, that is when the false Christs and prophets will thrive. So remember, the tribulation is a time of distress of the saints before the beginning of the day of the Lord. It is not God's wrath, the seals, the trumpets, or the bowls. This confusion has led to a lot of interpretational errors of eschatological events, leading people away from a clearer view of God's character, and I'm not quite sure where this definition came from. Based on this analysis, we can clearly see when the tribulation will be and what it will specifically entail. Almost every seal is articulated with at least three other sources, progressing as they progressed. The tribulation is only mentioned during this specific time, and we can conclude, also from other sources, this is when and how the great distress on the saints will happen. When life becomes difficult, remember who the foundation of your faith is. If the tribulation should happen in your lifetime, hold on to Jesus and remember these three verses.